outlines everything we have to do. It's the basis for all wetland procedures. It pulls from the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. And Section 12 is where you'll find most of your NRCS standards. This is the conservation area. This will outline what programs we have, such as CSP, the Conservation Stewardship Program, where your mitigation sites, which is what Wetland Index is. Your NRCS policies and procedures. This requires a site determination of your soils. Three things are used when we go on site: your vegetation, your hydrology, and your soils. If you have the vegetation and the hydrology, but not the soils, it's not a wetland. But if you have the soils, it's a wetland. A 1026, I know we shouldn't probably use jargon, but a 1026 is a form that the landowner will put in. This is a permission to clear and a site determination. He will put this in if he wants to clear a forest to make it farmable, he wants to add drainage, or if he's not sure if there's a determination on his site, such as is it hydric or is it non-hydric. The next is a 569. This is a violation to clear. This is if the farmer cleared without a site determination or if it was a wetland and he cleared it after 1985. A 657, this is the wetland restoration standard. This contains everything that you need in a wetland mitigation or restoration plan. The steps taken to create Wetland X. In 2015, the farmer submitted a 1026 for permission to clear his property. Upon that, we used aerial imagery using remote sensing to figure out what it was in 85. If farmland was cleared prior to 1985, it can be farmed. If it was cleared after 1985, it's required to have a determination on it. Upon review, we found that he cleared the site in 2015 using aerial imagery. This required us to go on site in 2015 with our area biologist Shannon Shaw and our area soil scientist Stephen Sprecher. Upon arriving on the site, they took soil samples and they found out that the site was actually hydric soils. It contained two types, Mandeville silt loam and Rhinebeck silt loam. After this findings, they had to meet with the farmer to inform him that he either needed to do a mitigation plan to stay in compliance and be eligible for USDA programs, or he had to pay all funding back for the year of 2015. The plan was created in 2016 after the farmer decided that he wanted to stay eligible for all his USDA programs. The plan was implemented that same year by area biologist Shannon Shaw. Monitoring was conducted by myself in 2017, which was an informal sampling method. We walked the site to see what we had. Upon walking the site, we found that the site was below its success criteria of 188 stems needed per acre. So we informed the farmer that he needed to plant some extra stems, and in 2018, I was able to conduct monitoring again, but we did it in a more formal manner. We'll go over how the sampling for 18 does a little later in this presentation. This is the imagery we use when we're going onto a site when we're in the office. This is what the site looked like in 1985. The blue outlines the site, the red is the converted wetland. The blue is created in order to create more of a polygon that's easier for farming, so he doesn't have the squiggly lines as you'll see down on the southern end. As you can see, it was forested back then. We determined it was an orchard or a pasture, which under Food Security Act is not considered agricultural land. You can't just clear an orchard, even though it's being farmed. In 2013, you can see the site is still forested. And in 2015 is when the change happened. The white lines running through the site are surface ditches that the farmer put in place. This is to clear water off the site. Water on the site runs north to south. He farms the north side and the south side. His goal when he did this was to attach both so he could make it one field. And this is what the site looks like in 2017, 1 year after the plan. As you can see, it's vegetated and the pothole is indicated by this area right here. There's also a roadway that runs across the top to allow access to his back field on the east side of the site. The pothole is 2 to 3 feet deep. This is to allow vegetation to grow. We're not trying to make a pond. We want this to be a forested wetland like it once was. We also decided that after this, and talking with the farmer, we'd make this a scrub shrub wetland for farming practices. This is to allow the site to be where it needs to be and have the same ecological functions, but to allow the farmer to not have his crop shaded on the edges. This is an image of the site driving along the roadway. You're facing east on the north side. The site currently contains mainly Canadian thistle, bull thistle, goldenrod, green canary grass, black locust. There is also several species of sedges and rushes, and in the pothole you can find narrowleaf and broadleaf cattail. This is an image looking south on the site. You can see the pothole is right here, and you can see there's not much woody vegetation on the site. This is a close-up of the pothole. You can see we have some narrowleaf cattail and some horsetails, and very far back towards the truck we have some eastern cottonwood that's starting to regenerate. The other image is by mentor Shannon Shaw, flagging out some black locusts for an invasive species control that we'll talk about later. You can also see there's queen anne's lace and goldenrod, which is not desired species for the site. So when we went out and monitored the site in 2018, we had four things we had to look at: the time of year we wanted to sample, our transect designs, our locations of these transects, and how we wanted to analyze our data. Monitoring was conducted in the first week of June. This was allowing for full leaf out. This is, makes it easier to identify your plants because it's easier to identify from a leaf than a bud. Our design, we used a zigzag transect which is located in yellow on the northern portion of the site. This was obtained from partnership with the USDA Plant Materials Center in Binghamton. It was conducted on the northern portion of the site as there's an old farm ditch that runs across there, so water pools. So the hope was when we're putting in wetland vegetation that maybe it survived there. We did a great transect using the New York State Rapid Assessment Model, which were located on the southern portions. The smaller one located just south of the pothole is outside of the converted wetland boundary. This was done as the farmer indicated to us that he had planted outside the boundary when it was originally flagged. So the hope was we could find some stems in this area. We also conducted a comparison site on the far east side. This was in an upland area that was flat. This was to allow for very little variation in data, such as farm inches, which when you fall off into a 4-foot ditch, is kind of not the best. And then our data collection analysis, we didn't know how we wanted to break down the data we got. So the questions we had with our data analysis were: how many woody stems per acre were present? How many species were present on the site? We went to evaluate the extent of native versus invasive species. The data we found was we had 9 species on the site, 8 native indicated in green, 1 invasive indicated in orange. There was a total of 99 stems, 71 native and 28 invasive. The good news to this was we met our minimum of 4 native 40 stem species on the site. The bad news was we had 1 invasive, which is highly aggressive as it's a nitrogen fixer and outcompetes most native vegetation in the black locust. So this meant that we had to conduct an invasive species protocol in the plan. So what we did, 2.09 acres per sample. Under USDA standards, we had to sample at least half the site to ensure that we got a great representation of the site. The 71 stems found was divided by 2. We had 34 stems per acre found. After doing an error calculation, we determined there was 41 stems on the site, accounting for stems that we missed. We're requiring 188 stems per acre. This was in the old plan as well. We had to have 188. We want to keep that same standard as that's required in USDA. He needed 154 to meet his standard. And the number of stems per acre we're requiring him to plant after all this is 210 stems. Once he plants 210 with a 75% survival rate, he'd have about 191 stems that survive. This is a little higher than what we're requiring. What this allows, in case there's a little bit more dead loss than what we're expecting to happen. So for the site, he has to plant 840 stems total for the site. So our comparison area, which was located on the far east part of the site, the grid and the zigzag transects were conducted, and the goal was to determine the most efficient way for NRCS staff to conduct a field investigation. Our vegetation comparison, we had 13 stems that were found during the grid transects and 8 that were found during the zigzag transects. 5 of the stems that were found during both. This can be shown with the silky dogwood. There was 2 stems found, but as indicated, they were found during both transects. 61% of the stems we found in this comparison were found during the grid transect. 39% were found during the zigzag transect. This is a 21% difference. This is pretty significant. We also did the sample time and the setup time. It took 19 minutes to set up the zigzag transect, and it took 20 to sample. took 11 to set up the grid transects and 35 to sample. So the difference in your setup time was 8 minutes and 15 for our sample time, for a total difference of 7 minutes. They also determined, talking with Shannon Schaub, there was too many variables to determine with this. It's very hard when you're sampling a site to do your sample time, because if somebody's 6'2", they're going to walk faster than somebody that's 5'1". If you're walking through a site that's a thicket, or if you've got 6-foot ditches in it, it's very hard to get an accurate assessment of time. So Shannon and I determined that we really didn't want to use this statistic when we're determining the most effective method. So the conclusions we had from our data analysis, our main finding was the site failed success criteria. We needed 188 stems per acre for the farmer to pass success criteria and remain eligible for USDA funding. This meant a mitigation plan amendment was necessary for the site. Our secondary findings, in speaking with Shannon Schaub, area biologist, we determined grid transects were the most effective method, because we're not out there to be quick about it. We want to find the stems that the farmer planted, which can be difficult sometimes. Our goal isn't to make him spend 3 months making another plan. We'd rather focus our time on something else and make sure we find the stems that he put the work in to do. But we'd also like to do further studies on those. I had the opportunity later that summer to do a comparison again on another site, and this coming summer, there should be 3 more sites they're going to do a comparison on, as they want to build data to figure out a good standard to use, so everyone's using the same methods. So the creation of the plan. I had to meet, after I sampled in 2018, with district conservationist Heath Eisel and area biologist Shannon Schaub. In this meeting, I had to tell them what I found and what I thought. This was that I found that the site did not meet criteria and I felt we needed to do an amendment to the plan. They gave me the okay, which meant I had to meet with the landowner. In meeting with the landowner, I informed him that we had to either implement a plan so he could remain eligible for USDA program funding, or he could not do the plan, but he had to pay back all funds that he received in his programs from 2015 to 2018. At the end of the meeting, he determined he wanted to do the amendment and remain eligible for his plan. So, in this process, we then collaborated with area biologist Shannon Schaub again to create the plan, and we had to make sure that all of the wetland restoration standard 657 was included. This is to make sure all standards and practices were implemented. If everything from the 657 standard isn't included, then the plan is void. It's not legally binding, and the farmer can get out of it without any issues. And we ended up paying the price for that on a few sites in the past. So the sections of the plan, this is not the main restoration plan that the farmer went through. So I did not have to have soils data, how they sampled the site in 2015. Information I had to have is what we did and what's required for him to get his vegetation back on the site. What does he need to do to be in success criteria? So the parts that we had are the purpose, his mitigation techniques and success criteria, his monitoring, and his participant responsibilities. The purpose clearly outlines the goal of the project. Our goal is 188 stems per acre and 4 different native woody stem species on the site. It outlines the findings. This will state that there was 41 stems per acre found, but there is 8 native stem species and there is 1 invasive found. It'll include when the plan needs to be implemented. By June 1st of 2018, it has to be implemented within a year of us doing the monitoring. And as we conduct the monitoring the first week of June, it has to be implemented before then. It's a tight deadline, but he should be able to accomplish it as he had this whole fall to get started on site prep. His mitigation techniques and success criteria. This has several sections and this outlines everything he has to do. This has his shrub establishment, his planting rates, species list, and his planting specifications. His planting rates is 210 stems per acre of 4 different native woody stem species. His species list contains 15 species that we know are found in nurseries close to his farm, so we know he can get them. Species include speckled alder, spice bush, high bush blueberry, red osier dogwood, silky dogwood, and several other species. Under planting specifications, he'll have his site prep, how he has to prepare the site. We're requiring him to do 2 herbicidal sprays. Once in the fall in September, he should have already conducted that. And then again, after spring thaw, this is to make sure that no weeds are competing with the vegetation. The sprays need to be with a 3-foot radius of where he puts the shrub, or in a 6-foot wide patch if he decides to plant in rows. His planting windows. He has from spring thaw notified Gramercy us that we're also instructing that he plants these with a shovel. Last time that he did this plant, he took a trencher out, made trenches, dropped the stems in, and just backfilled it. He didn't have a great success rate with it, as a lot of the stems kind of died. Most of them don't do well with a 4-foot ditch. Plant protection. We're requiring him to put a 30-inch tree tube on each shrub that's 5 to 6 inches in diameter. He needs to bury this tube 2 inches into the ground, as to ensure voles and other rodents cannot burn the shrub and kill it. It also needs to be staked in about 12 inches. This is to ensure that they can't blow over in windstorm or in the winters, as this site is located on a lake plain state, so it's flat. It's like the Great Plains almost. The next section, your mitigation techniques, is your operational maintenance. Operation outlines what he has to do, everything he has to do from watering to his site prep. Maintenance. This is where we're required to go out and monitor the site. Does he have pests on the site, such as aphids that are demolishing his trees? He has to go out and water, so if we have a drought like in 2018, he has to make sure the plants are surviving. And he has to make sure he has 180 stems per acre. He has to make sure he's meeting his success criteria of 180 stems per acre and 4 native 40 stem species. The next section will be his monitoring and participant responsibilities. Monitoring can be every year for 5 years during the growing season. The growing season is from June 1st to August 30th. Most monitoring, the goal is to do it at the end of August. This is to ensure the species and the plants have survived through the summer. In the summer of 2018, we had a very wet spring, but in August and July, it was very dry. So a lot of the sampling that I did in June, by the time we got to August for the final site meeting, some of those plants had died. There was one eastern cottonwood located on the roadway, and it had completely perished. So we did have some dead loss over the summer that was not calculated for. And it also outlined his responsibilities in this section. He has to establish and maintain the site. This means he has to make sure that everything outlined in his plan is working, 188 stems per acre. He's doing his herbicidal spraying. He has to protect his wetland from disturbance also. This means if he drives his tractor there, he's in trouble. So he has to clearly make sure the site is marked out so this does not happen when he's planting. You'd be surprised how many people drive their tractor through these sites. And he has to establish and maintain his shrubs and the shrub shelters. This means if the shelter blows off in the winter, he has to put it back on in the spring. He has to make sure they stay on the shrub for at least 5 years. At the end of the 5 years, he can take it off, or before that, we inform him, NSCS staff, that he can take it off. And he has to plant additional vegetation. If he doesn't plant additional vegetation, if he's below success criteria, he's out of compliance, which means he's not acceptable to get funding anymore. So this means if he ever falls below the 188 stems per acre, he needs to plant more stems to ensure he stays at his success criteria and is in compliance and remains eligible for USDA funding. Here's the site map. This is attached to the end of the plan. This is what the farmer will use and we will use to ensure that he's following it. This map is loaded into a Trimble, which is ArcGIS in your hand that USDA uses. It's very cool. Hopefully some of you get the chance to work with it. It makes things a lot easier than a data point on a garment. This site plan will outline his planting areas. The purple is the invasive species control. This is where black locust is located. We're requiring him to do a herbicidal spraying in this area. Typical NLCS standard is a cut stump treatment. This means he'll cut the black locust off and spray it with glyphosate. NRCS, though, cannot mandate him to do this, as we're not licensed herbicide applicators. He has to bring in a licensed herbicide applicator to do this. But we have to certify he did it in order for this plant to be fully successful. The yellow areas indicate where he's required to plant. The yellow area is 1.9 acres. We located in this area as there's an old farm ditch in this area, so we're hoping the water will cool in this area and allow species such as your spice bush, which likes water, to grow and prosper. The southern area has a lot of different variation. It's 2.1 acres. The southern finger that comes off, located here, was very difficult as water cools there, and just to the right of it, right about here, there's an old ditch with a ditch plug right here. We cannot plant species on this ditch plug, is to ensure that water holds on the site as it moves from north to south. We don't want water leaving the site. The pothole is indicated in blue, and this is 2 to 3 feet in depth. This is to ensure the vegetation can grow. We don't want a pond that's for bass fishing. We want frogs to use it, salamanders, amphibians to be able to use it, and for it to hold water, which in 2017, which is a wet summer, there was about 2 feet of water in it. 2018, it was dry. It's kind of hard to get that to fluctuate to work when it's such a shallow thing and it's so dry. Some acknowledgments I have, I would like to thank my mentor, Shanna Shaw. She's the West Area Biologist. I'd like to thank my supervisor, Keith Eisel. He's the District Conservationist for Dennis Ravine and Niagara County Field Team. I'd like to thank Celia Evans and Janet Meibach for being the independent capstone instructors and reading over this plan as much as they did. They helped me combine academic and real world, which was a bit of a headache at times to get it done, but it was well worth it, and it was a great learning experience. Any questions?
I'm going to talk to you more about soils after this, but with, overall, in the state, about how much acreage or hectares
also have another question